worship His majesty. Unto Jesus be all glory, power, and praise. Majesty, kingdom, authority, flow from His throne unto His own, His anthem raise. So exalt, lift up on high the name of Jesus. Magnify, come glorify Christ Jesus the King. Majesty, worship His majesty. Jesus who died, now glorified, King of all kings.
So exalt,
lift up on high the name of Jesus. Magnify, come glorify Christ Jesus the King. Majesty, worship His majesty. Jesus who died, now glorified, King of all kings. Jesus who died, now glorified, King of all kings.
Just in case I move, I don't know, that's a little loud there, Jared. I have to admit that maybe it is a little loud, guys. If you could turn the thing just a touch down, that'd be good. That this new schedule has got me a little bit nervous. As I look at a clock, I don't usually worry about the clock. But I know that the second service starts in half an hour. And I don't know if what I've got to say from the Lord is going to take just half an hour. So one thing I'm going to do is rather than have you look through all of the scriptures, I'm going to read most of them for us. But I would ask you to open up your Bibles, if you would please, to the book of John. But back a little bit to chapter 13. Book of John, chapter 13. And we'll start with you at least looking at some scripture here with me. And I'm going to read beginning in verse 33. There's three verses. Jesus is speaking and He says to His disciples, little children, I shall be with you a little while longer. You will seek Me, and as I said to the Jews, where I am going, you cannot come. So now I say to you, a new commandment I give to you, that you love one another as I have loved you, that you also love one another. By this all will know that you are My children, you are My disciples, if you have love for one another. It's after the Passover, and Jesus is once again telling His disciples that He has to go, that He is leaving them. Once again, His announcement is met with confusion, a little bit of anger, some resentments. Once again, He reassures them, however. As we go on to chapter 14 and the first few verses, as He says, let your hearts not be troubled. You believe in God, believe also in Me. In My Father's house are many mansions. If it were not so, I wouldn't have told you that. When I go to prepare a place for you, and if I go, I prepare to prepare a place for you, I will come again and receive you to Myself, so that where I am, there you may be also. And where I go, you know, and the way you know. What is this way? The Lord doesn't leave them thinking about it. He tells them. He says in verse 6, He is the way. He is the way. He is the truth. He is the life. No one comes to the Father except through Him. It's through Jesus and Jesus alone that we have the opportunity of eternal life. You know it. You've heard it many times. I know it. But sadly, so much of this world doesn't know it. Wouldn't it be wonderful if they did? Wouldn't it be wonderful if they knew Jesus? I wonder if there's anyone here who could honestly put up their hand and say, I don't know anyone who hasn't met Jesus before. Or I don't know anyone who maybe knew Jesus, but seems to have fallen away and has forgotten their first love in Jesus. Is there anyone here who would put up their hand? I don't think so. We all know someone. The saddest part is most often it's someone close to us. It's our family members. It's our children, our grandchildren, our brothers, our sisters. It's mothers and fathers. It's our workmates and our friends. The other thing we all know, because we've come to church for a long time, everyone here, I don't see anyone who hasn't, we also know, as readers of the Word and studiers of the Word of God, we know deep in our hearts. Deep in our hearts, we know it is our responsibility to make them, help them know. Not to make them know, but to help them know. It's our responsibility. So this morning, I want to look at a few well-known examples of how the good news was shared in the Bible. In the hope and the prayer that maybe it will help us, and I mean us, me too, become more fluent and more relaxed in sharing the truth of the gospel message with others. Because that's what we're supposed to do, right? It is our God-given purpose. You remember in Matthew 28, what does Jesus tell us? Go, he says, make disciples of all nations. And the first angel's message, which we cry out often in this church, and we hold up as a special message that this remnant church has, tells us to preach the gospel where? To all who dwell on the earth, to every nation, tribe, tongue, and people. This is the role for all God's children. He's asked us to fulfill that role, to glorify God by sharing the message of love that he has given to us. I want to begin by looking at chapter 4 of John. Chapter 4 of John. If your Bible is open, feel free to turn to it. Chapter 4 of John. And I'm going to read verses 6 and 7, where it says, Now Jacob's well was there. Jesus, therefore, was wearied from his journey. He sat thus by the well, and it was about the sixth hour. So it was around noon. The sun was high in the sky. A woman of Samaria came to draw water, and Jesus said to her, Give me a drink. You know the story. Here we find the lowest of the low. She's not just a woman. She's a woman of ill repute. She's so shunned by those in her village or town that she must come in the heat of the day when no one else would be at the well so that she isn't embarrassed to be there and cause embarrassment for others. And Jesus, putting aside all of the taboos of the culture at the time, speaks to her. In verse 26, he says, And this is the first time that he has made this pronouncement to anyone, not even to his disciples. He says to her in verse 26, I who speak to you am he. Who is he referring to? He's speaking of being the Messiah. This is the first sharing of these words with anyone since Jesus has come to bring his message. He puts aside all the taboos of the culture and speaks to her and tells her he is the Messiah to come. He is the provider of the living water of life that only God can provide. And the woman saw his face. She looked at him, and she saw, and she listened. And it says in verse 28 that the woman then left her water pot, went her way to the city, and said to the men, "Come, see the man who has told me all things that I ever did. Could this be the Christ?" Leaving her possessions at the well, leaving her water pot at the well. You know, water pots cost money. This was a humble woman. This was a woman who didn't have a lot, was shunned. So I can imagine this was something that was of value to her. And yet it says she just simply left it. It was an expensive choice, because if she came back later and it was broken or lost or stolen, she was out. She left what she had. Nothing else mattered to her when she saw the face of Jesus and saw who he was. "Come," she said, "come see the one who knows all about my sordid past. All of the things you have put me down for, I admit them. He has told me, and he knows. Could this be the Christ? He loves me. He loves me." How ready are we to leave the things of this world, to put the things aside that we have gathered, our toys, our comforts, the things that we enjoy, with no guarantees that they're going to be there tomorrow at all? How eager are we to put them aside when we have an opportunity to share Jesus? If we are truly honest today, many of us would admit that it's hard for us to share the Word of God with others, because we think it jeopardizes something that we have. It may be something material, financial. It may be simply the feelings that we have, that others would be uncomfortable, making us uncomfortable. Yet this woman who saw the face of Jesus left her water pot and went to tell those who disdained her, those who didn't care for her. And she cried, "Come, come and see what I have seen," in the face of this man. This woman lost all self-consciousness. She lost all worry about her possessions. And she bared her soul to those who were there in that village to say, "Come with me." It says in verse 39 that many of the Samaritans of that city believed in him because of the word of the woman who testified. Many came because of her testimony. Next, I want to look at the book of Mark. And you can switch back a little bit to the book of Mark, two books back, and turn to Mark 5 if you're checking in your Bible. It's always a nice thing to do. Mark chapter 5. This is absolutely one of my favorite stories, and you all know it very well. It's a favorite story. It's a story of the demoniacs. Jesus has come across the sea. He's been come for a special purpose, for these people. Actually, in Mark, he talks of only one demoniac. The other scriptures that speak of this story speak of two. But here we're told of the tortured soul of men possessed by demons. Nothing could hold them. They were frightening in their person and in their actions as they wandered about the hills, howling in pain and despair as they went into the caves and out into the fields of the Gadarenes. They did not have a happy life. We know this story well. Verses 18 to 13, or 8 to 13, it says, "For he said, 'Come out of the man, unclean spirit.' And then he asked him, 'What is your name?' And he answered, saying, 'My name is Legion, for we are many.' Also he begged him earnestly that he would not send them out of the country. Now a large herd of swine was feeding there near the mountains, so all the demons begged him, saying, "Send us to the swine, that we may enter them." And at once Jesus gave them permission. Then the unclean spirits went out and entered the swine. There were about 2,000, and the herd ran violently down the steep place and into the sea and drowned in the sea. Jesus took the unclean spirits, legions of unclean spirits, and threw them out of these men who had suffered as they carried them about in their lives. And then he was confronted by the people of the land, and they invited him to leave because he had affected their livelihood. Now, Jesus doesn't force himself on anybody. He doesn't force himself on you or me. He doesn't tell us to believe him. He doesn't tell us to take our belief in him to someone or else. He simply asks. And so when he was asked to leave, he went to get into the boat. And verse 18 says, when he got into the boat, he who had been demon-possessed begged him that he might be with him. That he might be with him. He begged him. It's understandable, don't you think? These men had been in chains. These men had been cutting themselves. These men had been howling and alone, cold, wet, naked, all of this time. And now they were made whole through looking in the face of Jesus. And so they didn't want to leave. There's no way they wanted to leave the side of Jesus, the one who had brought them comfort and joy and peace. He had seen the face of Jesus, and he didn't want to lose the sight of his Savior. But Jesus said to him, go, in verse 19, go home to your friends and tell them what great things the Lord has done for you and how he has had compassion on you. And what did the man do? What did the men do? They went. They went. Can you imagine the disappointment they first felt, though? Just being released from these demons? Can you imagine the difficult circumstances of having to go before people who have seen your wretched, naked body and heard your woeful cries in the middle of the night, causing fear and worry, disgust? People who had feared you, people perhaps who had pitied you for so long, and now you are to stand before them and speak to them as equals? That is a scary proposition. I think it's a lot scarier than what I face in sharing God with my neighbors. I know my neighbors well. We are equals in many ways. Why am I afraid? This man was not afraid. He had seen the face of Jesus. Jesus told him to go, and he went. And it says in verse 20, he departed, began to proclaim in Decapolis all that Jesus had done for him. And all marveled. We're told that later when Jesus returned to this region, he didn't find just a couple of men who wanted to talk to him and a whole bunch of people herding sheep who wanted him to leave. He found thousands who flocked to him to find out more about this man called Jesus. These tortured souls had seen the face of Jesus and their lives had been changed. There was no embarrassment, no fear of rejection. They had seen his face. And that was all that mattered. Now, I sincerely hope, as I have been speaking about the face of Jesus and of people seeing the face of Jesus, that you understand what I mean. I'm not talking about his physical face. I'm not talking about the length of his beard or the color of his face, whether he has blue eyes or brown eyes. I'm not talking about his height, his cleanliness, his clothing. I'm not talking about any of that. I'm talking about who he was. When these people saw the face of Jesus, what they saw was a man who loved them. I'm talking about the love that he had for each person that he dealt with. I'm talking about what he did. I'm talking about his character. That is what we are to see when we look into the face of Jesus. That is the face that we see as we read the scripture and hear His voice in our prayer and respond to the guidance of the Holy Spirit in our lives, we begin to see the face of Jesus. Who is this man of love? That is the face of Jesus shared in the humility, in the obedience of the woman at the well and the demon-possessed men of the Gadarenes. That's what we're supposed to look for. One last example. Now reading in John chapter 1. John chapter 1. And verses 37 to 39. It introduces us to some people that we get to know much more about later. It says the two disciples heard him speak. They're talking about John the Baptist. And they followed Jesus. And then Jesus turned and seeing them following, said to them, "What do you seek?" And they said to him, "Rabbi," which is to say when translated teacher, "where are you staying?" And he said to them, "Come and see. Come and see." This is the story of the very beginning of the Christian church. As disciples are brought to Jesus by others who saw his face clearly and could not hold the joy that they saw in Jesus Christ within their own hearts. At the witness of Jesus' baptism, Andrew, seeing the face of Jesus, was drawn to respond to Jesus. And Jesus said, "Come, come and see." And Andrew then went to his brother Simon, called Peter, and brought him to Jesus. And then later on in this chapter, the Bible tells us of Philip, who saw Jesus and answered his call to follow him. And as a result, he was compelled to urge his brother Nathanael, skeptical though he may have been, that anything good could come out of Nazareth, to come and see. Each one, when they came, when they saw the face of Jesus, his love, his desire for their good, the joy in their heart, all compelled them to share him with others that they knew. Ellen White offers us a couple of startling statements. The first one is this. She says in Desire of Ages, as she talks about these people, with the calling of John, Andrew, and Simon, of Philip and Nathanael, began the foundation of the Christian church. This is how the Christian church began, one seeking another, sharing the love of Jesus with another. She says, these examples should teach us the importance of personal effort, of making direct appeals to our kindred, friends, and neighbors. You know, there are so many stories in the Bible that speak of people of all stature and upbringing. Men and women, rich and poor, when they see the face of Jesus, they are changed from within. And they cannot hold the joy that is within them any longer. They must share his love. And so they fulfill the commission that he has given us by sharing Jesus' truth and love and goodness. And every one of the stories, if you look at them, there are commonalities. And the main one is that they simply shared the testimony they had. They simply talked about how Jesus had been in their life. What they saw in Jesus, they shared with others. And as they looked into the face of Jesus and sought to follow him, you also notice that none were found unworthy. None were told, "Yes, you may follow me," as soon as you attend seminary, as soon as you read all of the books of the Bible, as soon as you learn how to do a Bible study. You don't have to search the church manual. Jesus says, "Come, come to me, and take my message out to others." None were even told, if you noticed, to memorize the scripture. All, though, were urged to follow the example that Jesus gave. All were compelled to share the love they witnessed in the face of Jesus. So my question today, the question that has been bothering me as I thought about this and read these scriptures, the question is, what is wrong? What is stopping us? What is wrong with Grand Prairie? What is stopping Grand Prairie from rushing this church and joining us in worshiping God? Why have they not seen Jesus? Why has my brother not seen Jesus? Why do my children still really don't see Jesus? Why? Once again, I sound a rebuke from Ellen White. To me, to us as a church, I believe. Page 141 of Desire of Ages, she says, there are those who for a lifetime have professed to be acquainted with Christ, yet who have never made a personal effort to bring even one soul to the Savior. They leave all the work to the minister. He may be well qualified to his calling, but he cannot do that which God has left to the members of the church to do. There are many who need the ministration of loving Christian hearts. Many have gone down to ruin who might have been saved if their neighbors, common men and women, just common men and women, had put forth personal effort for them. Many are waiting to be personally addressed. In the very family, my very family, my neighborhood, my town, where we live, there is work for us to do as missionaries for Christ. If we are Christians, this work will be our delight. No sooner is one converted than there is born within him a desire to make known to others what a precious friend he has found in Jesus. The saving and sanctifying truth cannot be shut up in his heart. You don't need to preach and share him. Doesn't mean you need to give Bible studies. It doesn't mean you need to become an elder. You don't have to stand on a street corner in Grand Prairie and hand out tracts. Although it might be a good thing for some of us to start doing. All you really need to do is look into the face of Jesus. Look into his eyes. Find out what he is like by reading your Bible and studying your scripture. See his love, his compassion, his mercy. And then invite him to shine that through you to others. You know, John 14:9 says, if you've seen me, you've seen the Father. And as modern day disciples, we can show others the Father through Jesus if we know him and seek his face. At the end of our lesson four, there was a man introduced to us in the mission story called David Kim. He's an executive. He runs in pretty good circles. He hobnobs with wealthy people. And he talked about how he shared Jesus. And I think there was some advice there that we could live by. He said when he's asked, for instance, how was your weekend? Have you ever been asked that? Sure you have. How was your weekend? He answers, well, I went to church on Saturday. And then I enjoyed some time with my family. When he's asked as an executive, how do you keep the balance of your life between being an executive and being a family man? He says, it's difficult. It's difficult. But what I've found is that my prayer life really helps. You know, after I read this, it made a difference to me. I sat by people in the plane, and I saw people in Costco that I knew. And they asked, well, now what are you doing with yourself, being retired? I haven't seen you since we were in school and all this kind of thing. I can say to them, you know, I find I fill my time wonderfully. I volunteer at Heritage Lodge. We do Bible studies there. And the people are just amazing. You see, you don't need anything special to share Jesus. All you need is conversation with those that you know. Introduce Jesus. Opportunities are there with every conversation. Bring him into the conversation. The Holy Spirit will do the rest. All we need to do is share. It's a little late, but I want to read this last quote from Ellen White, because it tells us about a bonus that we have if we share Jesus' love. From Reflecting Christ, she says, he who begins with a little knowledge in a humble way and tells what he knows while seeking diligently for further knowledge will find the whole heavenly treasure awaiting his demand. The more he seeks to impart light, the more light we are going to receive. The more we try to explain the Word of God to others with a love for souls, the plainer it becomes for ourselves. The more we use our knowledge and exercise our powers, the more knowledge and power we shall have. Every effort made for Christ will react in blessing upon ourselves. If we use means for His glory, He will give us more. As we seek to win others to Christ, bearing the burden of souls in our prayers, our own hearts will throb with the quickening influence of God's grace. Our own affections will glow with more divine fervor. Our whole Christian life will be more of a reality, more earnest, more prayerful. A blessing awaits us all if we share the gospel of Jesus Christ. I'm going to make an appeal today. As I worked on this sermon, I knew I had to do this. And I'm going to ask Trudy to just play softly for a moment. Because I want to tell you something. I know without a shadow of a doubt that as Seventh-day Adventist Christians who have attended this church for days, for weeks, for months, for years, many, for decades, every one of us knows more about Jesus than the vast majority of the people we see every day in Grand Prairie. Every one of us has more knowledge about Jesus than probably most of the people who attend the other churches, because we are students of the Bible. But knowledge is not enough. Learning the lessons isn't enough. This is a specific appeal I want to make today. Have you seen the face of Jesus? If you have, it's time to share. It's time to bring Him to your conversations and share. But if you're like perhaps many of us who feel in our hearts that we want to share Him, we really desire to share Him. Despite coming to the church every week, however, we just haven't been able to muster up the energy, the desire, the willingness to give up something. Our feelings of the moment or something material. And we have failed to share Him. If you want to share Jesus, if you truly desire today to say, Lord, I want to see Your face, I want to look in Your eyes, and I want to know about the love that You have in a way that changes me and allows me to shine that through, I want you to just simply to stand. That's all. If you are wanting to share Him, if you say to yourself this week, I am going to bring Him into my conversation with someone, let the Lord lead from that point. I don't care. It'll be the Lord who leads. But if you want to bring Him, thank you so much. If you want to lead someone to Jesus, you must share Him. And so if you are willing to commit to God, because you're not doing before this before my eyes. You know, before you stand, remember, you're not doing this before my eyes. This plea, this appeal is to share Jesus this week. And you're doing this before the eyes of God. You're going to bring Him up in conversation so that someone else may see the face of Jesus. Just want to have a prayer with us all right now before we sing our final song. Father God, we have stood before You because we have seen Your face, Lord. And in it we see the love. And it's strange how that love breaks our hearts and makes us weep. But it's because we also see ourselves. Lord, we need Your strength. We need Your power. We need You to be beside us as we go into this world. Lord, we need to share Your face with others. And so we ask a special blessing for all who have committed today, before Your eyes, that today, this week, somewhere along the way, they are going to bring You into the conversation so they may share Your love with others. Please bless us all. In Jesus' name I pray. Amen. You know, in John 21, Jesus tells Peter, by extension to us, how we are to do it. He says, if we love him, feed his lambs. If we love him, tend his sheep. If we love him, feed his sheep. That is our calling. Your commitment has been made. I pray that you have the strength through the Holy Spirit to follow through this week. Let's sing our closing song. It's number 183. 183? Yep.